Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Now it is 6 times. Oh, Krishna. Too bad. There are my glasses. 69.
Aham pura bhavam kasche.
Aham pura bhavam kasche.
Gandharva upavarana.
Gandharva upavarana.
Namna tite mahakalpe.
Namna tite mahakalpe.
Gandharvanam susamataha.
Gandharvanam susamataha.
Aham pura bhavam kasche.
Aham pura bhavam kasche.
Gandharva upavarana.
Gandharva upavarana.
Namna tite mahakalpe.
Namna tite mahakalpe.
Gandharvanam susamataha.
Gandharvanam susamataha.
Aham pura bhavam kasche.
Aham pura bhavam kasche.
Gandharva upavaranaha.
Gandharva upavaranaha.
Namna tite mahakalpe.
Namna tite mahakalpe.
Gandharvanam susamataha.
Gandharvanam susamataha.
Aham pura bhavam kasche.
Aham pura bhavam kasche.
Gandharva upavaranaha.
Gandharva upavaranaha.
Namna tite mahakalpe.
Namna tite mahakalpe.
Gandharvanam susamataha.
Gandharvanam susamataha.
Aham pura bhavam kaschit.
Aham pura bhavam kaschit.
Gandharva upavaranaha.
Gandharva upavaranaha.
Namna tite mahakalpe.
Namna tite mahakalpe.
Gandharvanam susamataha.
Gandharvanam susamataha.
Ladies.
Aham pura bhavam kaschit.
Aham pura bhavam kaschit.
Existed as.
Existed as.
Kaschit. Gandharva.
Gandharva.
One of the denizens of Gandharva Loka. Upabharhanaha. Upabharhana.
Namna.
By the name.
By the name.
Atiti.
Atite.
Long, long ago.
Long, long ago.
Mahakalpe.
Mahakalpe.
In a life of Brahman.
In the life of Brahman.
Which is known as a Mahakalpa.
Which is known as a Mahakalpa.
Gandharvana.
Gandharvana.
Among the Gandharvas.
Among the Gandharvas.
Susamataha.
Susamataha.
A very respectable person.
A very respectable person.
Long, long ago, in another Mahakalpa, millennium of Brahma, I existed as the Gandharva known as Upabarhana. I was very respected by the other Gandharvas. Purport. Sri Narada Muni is giving a practical example from his past life. Formerly, during the previous lifetime of Lord Brahma, Narada Muni was one of the denizens of Gandharva Loka, but unfortunately, as will be explained, he fell from his exalted position in Gandharva Loka, where the inhabitants are extremely beautiful and expert in singing, to become a sudra. Nonetheless, because of his association with devotees, he became more fortunate than he was in Gandharva Loka. Even though cursed by the Prajapatis to become a sudra, in his next life, he became the son of Lord Brahma. The word Mahakalpa is described by Srimad Vacharya as Atita Brahma Kalpa. Brahma dies at the end of a life of many millions of years. The day of Brahma is described as Bhagavad Gita 8.17, Sahasra Yuga Paryantam Aharyat Brahmano Vidu, Ratrim Yuga Sahasrantam, Tehu Ratra Vidu Janaha. By human calculation, 1,000 ages taken together is the duration of Brahma's one day. And such also is the duration of his night. Bhagavan Sri Krishna can remember incidents from millions of years ago. Similarly, his pure devotee, like Narada Muni, can also remember incidents from a past life, millions and millions of years ago. Om Agyanati Marandasya Gyanandana Salakya Shakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Vishnam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Seyuta Padakamalam Shri Gurum Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatam Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvitam Savadutam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Sivisakam Vitamscha Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesa Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kansana Gurange Radhe Vrindavane Sri Vishwanama Sute Devi Pranamami Priye Vanchaka Padrubhya Cha Kripa Sindhu Vyaiva Cha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Adaita Gadadara Shri Vasadeva Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare.
Yeah, this holy name. It's hard to stop.
So Narada Muni, in his discussion with Maharaj Yudhisthira, is giving different examples of transcendence. Yesterday, we saw how Maharaj Yudhisthira was able to defeat many kings who were extremely powerful, many warriors who were, in a sense, more powerful than himself, as powerful as elephants, and yet he was able to defeat them. Oh. Today we are seeing that Narada Muni describes how he was a Gandharva in a previous life, and somehow or other, that is not being discussed today, somehow or other he fell down, came to planet Earth, became the son of a maidservant, a sudra. But then, in that life, he got more devotional service. Certainly, in the heavenly planets, the worship of the Supreme Personality of Godhead was there. It was not just that he wasn't hearing about Krishna. He was. And he was engaged in so many rituals, because in the higher planetary systems, everything is going on according to prescribed duty. It is there that the society of the devatas is controlled by the mode of goodness. So in that way, in the mode of goodness, everything is done properly. It is said in the middle planetary systems where we are, everything is done in the mode of passion. So the mode of passion is, I want to do what I feel. And then there is this nagging reminder from, no, there is also prescribed duty. But in the heavenly planets, they are looking for prescribed duty. It is, how do you do it? How is it supposed to be done? That is natural. So, but somehow or other, Upabharana deviated from that principle. He deviated from that principle of looking for what is the proper way to do something. And he just didn't. He got spontaneous. And he turned his tambura into some sort of, he used it for making a love song. Now, love songs are very, there are love songs blasting out of speakers all over the world. But in the heavenly planets, it's unheard of. I mean, that was like unthinkable, outrageous, you know what I mean? A love song about the affairs of mundane affairs. No, song is for glorification of the Supreme Lord in the heavenly planets. So then, go down to planet Earth, and there you can have as many love songs as you like. Oh, well. Interesting. But leaving that aside, that's just a colorful detail. The real thing, the real essence of the whole verse is that Narada then came down, Upabharana came down, but in that life he was more fortunate than even being a Gandharva. Because in that life, he got the association of pure devotees. Anyabhilasita sunyam jnana karmadi anavritam. Not covered. Anavritam. Not covered by karma or jnana. Krishna anushilanam. Always, always cultivating their Krishna consciousness. Uttama bhaktas. Uttama beyond tamas. Uttama is the topmost devotees, and it basically means uttama means beyond the influence of ignorance. Because whatever our position is, whether we are in the mode of goodness, whether we are in the mode of passion, whether we are in the mode of ignorance, in all these positions we are covered to a degree by ignorance. So even those who are in the mode of goodness are still covered by a certain extent of ignorance, because they are not becoming ecstatic upon chanting the holy name of the Lord. In the quote book that I gave you yesterday, there's a quote where it says that if you chant the holy name for 100 lifetimes, then you will be able to to chant it constantly. So keep on chanting. A 100 lifetimes. What is that? We also saw in the play last night, even for Mukunda, 1,000,000 lifetimes. That's nothing. So what is 100 lifetimes? So already someone should get ecstatic. No, 100 lifetimes. I can chant constantly, isn't it? So this is so nice. But still, because we're from the age of Kali, they go, oh, 100 lifetimes. 100? Oh, gosh. I'm never going to make it 100. I mean, even 1 is already, like, gosh, difficult. And now you want 100. Yeah, no, I don't think it's for me then. So, no, don't worry. When, due to Lord Chaitanya's mercy, now, so quickly, the result is there. That even, like, you know, even 1 lifetime will do. It will do, somehow or other. Then, by mercy we will be carried to the spiritual world, and then somewhere on the way, love of God will also manifest in the heart. And then we can chant in ecstasy. Anyway, so Bhagavatam is describing this process of pure and unalloyed devotional service. Dharma prujita kaitavo traparamo nirmat saranam satam. For the non-envious, who are not interested in any cheating religion, in any kaitava dharma, who are not interested in any ritual for getting material blessings, or who are not interested in liberation from this material world, who are simply interested. Janmani, janmani, svare bhavatat bhakti rahaita kitvai. Simply life after life, serving Krishna. If somehow or other, I may be allowed to do some devotional service. But it takes time to become humble, right? To actually appreciate devotional service. See, as we are proud, we cannot fully appreciate devotional service. It is not possible. It is not possible. The pride gets in the way, and the pride makes us think of ourselves, and we can only really approach Krishna and appreciate the mercy of devotional service by being very humble. And well, Krishna makes arrangements to make us humble. All these beatings of the material energy which we are getting, everybody, I guess. I mean, some people, I sometimes meet someone who says, I've never suffered. Really? I think you're suffering from amnesia. I mean, come on. I've never suffered. It's like one of my examples is that I read in Prabhupada's, I forgot actually where I read it, but Prabhupada was explaining how in Vedic times they knew they had many herbs and they didn't need this whole modern medical industry, and they had one herb for tooth problems. You just touch the herb to a tooth and all the bacteria would leave. And then I had this tooth, you know. And the dentist said, extraction, extraction, extraction. And they said, oh, it looks like a complicated one. We'll send you to a specialist. So my dentist is very friendly. He goes like, oh, does it hurt? I'm so sorry, you know. But the specialist was a huge guy. Big arms, you know, and like, he didn't mess around, you know, you open your mouth and okay, it's like start trying to get this thing out, and I heard it crunching, okay, I heard it crunching, and I was thinking of that herb, and I said, if only I would have known that herb, the were missing Herb, I wouldn't be sitting here today. So, talking about not suffering, it reminds me of another story. I did a program in Soweto once. Soweto is a part of Johannesburg where 3 million African people have a lot of history. So we did a garage program somewhere. And I asked the question, is there anybody who's in control of his life? Is there anybody here who's in control of his life? And one man raised his hand. And he had a band-aid on his finger. And it was really interesting. It's just, you know, little things like that, we see in life, and we just laugh because we see through Srimad Bhagavatam. And you say, you know, you're in illusion. You're not in control of your life, you know. A band-aid, you know. Yeah. So, in this way, one who is beginning to see reality will automatically become humble. When you realize, I'm not in control, then we come to the point. Maybe I need blessings. Sachinandan Maharaj years ago does good slideshows, and he did this one slideshow which was called The Power of Blessings, and I really liked that one. It was just showing how people would go for blessings, and then he had got many examples. He had one example of women that didn't have a child, right? And nowadays, you know, you go to these fertility clinics and they analyze this and that, and you know, they freeze some parts of, like, anyway, I don't want to get into all the gory details of all that. And previously, they would just go to a holy place and pray and try and go for blessings. And these things, how nice, right? How nice. Instead of this demoniac thing, you know, where man, through his mechanical arrangements, is trying to overpower the material energy. It doesn't work, no problem. We have a shortcut in the laboratory. Stick your hand out and puff, we put a needle in there to begin with, you know. More coming. Just a little sample. Yeah, and then the principles of Dharma have to be temporarily tabled. So how nice is it when things can just be done by relying on more powerful personalities. When the devotees were worried about the Cold War between the countries behind the Iron Curtain and all that, and the West, and that some nuclear bomb might drop, then they were talking to Prabhupada about it, and they said, you know, the most terrible thing about these bombs is that even if you survive the explosion, you will still die a terrible death from the radioactive fallout. And Prabhupada's saying, he said, the whole world will be covered in radioactivity. And Prabhupada said, you know. He said, radioactive fallout is not a problem. The demigods will adjust everything in a moment. If we simply chant Hare Krishna, they will cooperate. They have another way of controlling the material energy beyond our imagination. Some of you may not have heard my example. My example is just like for ants. For an ant, sugar is like the most desirable thing. I actually read somewhere that they make alcohol out of the sugar. Just for your information. Yeah, that's why they're so into sugar. Anyway, sugar. So the ants, they like sugar a lot, and The Imagine that it would rain sugar from the sky. That would be a miracle for ants. Right? When it starts raining sugar, that's like perfection of life. That's like paradise. Right? It rains sugar. And for an ant, this would be an absolute miracle. But when you're a human being, even a child can do it. And in fact, children love to do it. Take the sugar pot, turn it upside down, and it's raining sugar. Any child can do it. Very easy. So what is beyond their scope of power is very easy for human beings and yet inconceivable to them. In the same way, what is beyond the scope of our power is very, very easy for superior personalities. So why would we rely on the scope of our little power? As Ram Nomi was going on, every year I go for like a week into the Ramayana, right? Like serious reading of the Ramayana. And this year I was reading about the point where Ravana, after performing his initial austerities, was ready to test his power. So he was going around and he had already taken the plane from his half-brother, Kuvira, and he was flying around in this plane, which would fly at will, and it was all going really well. But yeah, life was a little tame because there was just no one with any power at all. Right? I mean, he was just defeating everyone so easy that it got boring. But then Narada Muni came. And Narada Muni said, why would you waste your time challenging these human beings, these puny little creatures? Right? He said, they are so powerless and their life is so filled with misery and it is so short, right? Why would you even bother with humans? Go and fight with Yamaraj. And then he said he would be a good opponent because no one has been able to defeat death. Sounds good, brother. Anyway, there in the Ramayana there was a whole page describing the poor existence of human life. When you realize that, my God, that's us. So always plagued by diseases, you know. The worms are eating them like at every moment from the inside. If some of you are forgetful, you might think that you have some sort of maybe something in the blood or the blood pressure. But it is said, I read it. You read so many things these days. Now you don't know where you read it because of the internet, but I read that they are finding out that it's worms that eat holes in the brain. So if there's something you forget, you actually have a hole in your brain. And eventually your brain becomes like a sponge, full of holes. And then you're kind of like, oh, you know. Isn't that interesting? When you hear things like that, it kind of illustrates a little bit the point I was making about the limited nature of human existence. So Narada Muni had previously been a Gandharva, so much superior, and now put down to this lower level of existence of a human being, right? A smelly human being. And then, you know, and yet, that was the life which was most fortunate. Because he got in contact with the Bhakti Vedantas.
Oh, yeah, what a coincidence. We also have one. A.C. Bhakti Vedanta Swami Prabhupada. And somehow or other, we know very well that he is present. I think we know the story of New Vrindavan, which is the story about Prabhupada's shoes and how so many tourists would come to New Vrindavan to see the palace of gold and so on. But then, whatever, a twist of fate, for some time in the family there was a little bit of separation, and for a little while New Vrindavan was kind of on its own, officially separated from ISKCON. But Prabhupada was there, but the standards of things also changed quite a bit. Robes and so many things. The songs also changed a bit. They became anglicized. Whatever, you know, I'm not getting into passing any judgment about that. I'm just telling a story. And the story is that some tourists came and they were looking here and there, and they were in front of Prabhupada, the Murti of Prabhupada, which is very nice. And then someone said, and here is the ceiling. And it is decorated, very refined, and it has all been done by the devotees, and all the tourists were looking up at the ceiling. And then one lady, she heard the Murti say, take my shoes. Take my shoes. And she's looking, who said that? And then again, the Murti says, take my shoes. She said, oh, no, but how can I do that? I've never stolen anything in my life. A very decent lady, you know. I mean, it's rare to find such ladies nowadays. But she never stole anything in her life. Quite amazing. And then, yeah, take my shoes. And the voice was so forceful, she just grabbed them and put them in her bag. Yeah, and then, well, the tour went on and she went home. And then, yeah, their shoes, you know, anyway, put them somewhere in the house and sort of. And they stayed there for a long time. And she forgot all about them. Right? But then New Vrindavan things changed, and after some time they came again closer, not just to ISKCON, but to aligning with the way Prabhupada had set standards, like not giving sannyas to women is an example, which they were doing. And then this lady, one night, she had a dream of Prabhupada, and Prabhupada comes in the dream, and he says to her, now you can return my shoes. I have come back. I have come back. You can return my shoes. And then, wow, you know, I mean, it was a very vivid dream. So she wrote it down, packed the story of the dream, and sent the shoes in a letter, sent them back to the temple. So that parcel arrived in the temple. So, well, I don't know that much about deity worship, to be honest. But the shoes, they play a big role. Because, for example, when you put the deities to rest, you put a bed, but you cannot pick up the whole deity. The deity, we don't move. Not that we pick up the whole deity and tuck the deity in the bag. Okay, Gopinati, are you warm enough? No, he will stay on the altar. But what happens is we take the shoes and put the shoes next to the bed. And in that way, so the shoes are sort of representing the deity.
And Prabhupada said, return my shoes to the lady, and I've come back. It means that for a little while he had withdrawn from his murti. But it also means that he came back. It also means that he's here, right now, in the murti, fully present, you see, where we're going. Do I even dare to speak? Anyway, Prabhupada made his disciples speak in front of him, and Lord Chaitanya also made his associates speak in front of him. So I guess I'll speak. But this is very significant. So these things we should remember. Prabhupada is still present. There's two letters which I like, and in one letter, Srila Prabhupada is describing what happened to his spiritual master after the departure, and he says, my spiritual master now has returned back to the spiritual world, and he has again assumed his original svarup of a manjari, right, in the spiritual world. Gopinath Acharya told me yesterday, it's not manjari, it's manjari. Okay, got it now, manjari. So, he has taken his original form. So that's the one letter. So the one letter is clearly describing how Srila Bhaktisiddhanta went to the spiritual world and how he exists there eternally. Then shortly after, there's another letter. And the other letter says, now that my spiritual master has returned to the spiritual world, I know that he's still watching everything I do. He's still watching everything I do. So when I read that, to me that was very striking. Because I was thinking, oh, if it is like that, that they are in the spiritual world and still also watching everything we do, if Bhaktisiddhanta is doing that with his disciples, surely Prabhupada is doing it with all of us. So, she writes in the beginning of Bhagavatam, he lives forever in his instructions, and the follower lives with him. And that is there. So, by following Prabhupada's instructions, we're living with Prabhupada forever, he says. He lives forever. But More than that, the whole story illustrates how Prabhupada is also still personally present in our life. So, grandfather, great-grandfather, or something like that, whatever may be, we can still get his mercy, we can still get his blessings. And that is very important, so we're not in any way distant. When I encounter devotees, some devotees, they say, well, I've never met Prabhupada, I don't know Prabhupada, therefore, you know, we are looking at you, right? Because we know you. Yeah, I don't know, you know, if you know me. I'm not sure. but you know something. Prabhupada, in a way, I know him better than I know my own father. Because my father, he told me many stories about his life. And some, I guess, were exaggerated. But anyway, I'm guessing. But we know so much about Prabhupada's life, about his activities, about everything. And each little thing that we know is blessing us. That is blessing us. So we need these blessings. Just bring in these blessings by hearing about the pure devotees, by serving the pure devotees. And this whole movement is dedicated to that. And then just like Prabhupada said, he said, I don't know why this miracle happened to me. that all these people came? I don't know. He said, many of my god brothers, they were very, very qualified. Prabhupada meaning to say, in some ways, more learned, more qualified in some aspects. That's what Prabhupada was explaining. And it wasn't like just... Of course, Prabhupada was very learned, but Srila Bhaktisiddhanta had some amazingly scholarly disciples because he was a very scholarly spiritual master. So in terms of... But then Prabhupada said, but... So why did this miracle happen to me? I can think of only one thing, because I 100% followed the order of my spiritual master. So in that way, we see how Prabhupada points out that maybe he was not the most powerful one in terms of all the attributes, just like Yudhisthira, who was, and Arjuna. They were not like the most powerful personalities on the whole battlefield of Kurukshetra. But they simply took shelter of Krishna. They simply surrendered to Krishna and tried to do it the way Krishna and his representatives wanted it to be done. And then Krishna helped. Krishna was there so many times, so many times. Krishna was helping, and then everything became possible. In the verse book, I also put that section which describes Arjuna's chariot, because I like that story. I mean, and at the end of the battlefield, suddenly Krishna says, Arjuna, take your bow, take your arrows, and get down from the chariot. So Arjuna obeys, he gets down from the chariot. Next moment, the whole chariot goes up into flames. So you can just see Arjuna, my car! It's like, it's a big thing, right? His car catches fire right in front of him. And so it's like, And then Arjuna said, but how is this possible? How is this possible? This chariot has, has been attacked by the most powerful weapons. Even the Brahmastra could not harm it. Yeah? How can this chariot burn now? And Krishna was saying, because actually all along I was protecting it. I was all along invisibly protecting it. And now that it's not needed anymore, now that the battle is over, now I withdraw that protection. And now the power of all these astras has to act. And the chariot immediately burned to ashes. And all along, Arjuna was driving his car, and he was thinking, cool, daddy, cool, cruising along, I'm on top of the world, mate. check it out. And then, in a moment, in a snap, it all changed. And suddenly, gone, car gone. Intense, huh? Muy intenso. So in this way, we can appreciate how there's a whole invisible arrangement in our life of the Supreme Personality of Godhead and other more powerful personalities that do all kinds of things, and we got no idea, no idea. Another example is, you come in into the Hare Krishna movement. We come from a background which was not always. if you know what I mean. It wasn't always all kosher. But then, somehow or other, we change, we become devotees, and we chant Hare Krishna for a little while, and Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, and then we start,
look at these people. They're totally in Maya, you know. Oh, they're so degraded, you know. Gosh. I mean, look at what they eat. Oh, gosh. You know. And so on, and look what they do, and, you know, and then of course, you know. We are not at all affected by these things, you know, like me, Maya. Doesn't affect me. It's not because of us. It's because of the invisible force of the Supreme Lord, who is invisibly getting in the way. Lord Chaitanya blocking all the arrows of Cupid, you know. Otherwise, you know, you fall in love 10 times a day or more. Yeah. And even now it sometimes happens with the protection of Lord Chaitanya. Can you imagine that? Yeah. Bhakti Romeo and Bhakti Julia. All these things are there. So we just appreciate how much we rely on the protection of Lord Chaitanya, the protection of Srila Prabhupada, the protection of the demigods, the protection of Krishna, and of Srimad Radharani, and all of them, right? And in that way, we are protected. Of course, some, they straight away want to go to Vrindavan. That's what I did. I went straight away to Vrindavan. I went straight away to Radha and Krishna. And only later I got to Gornitai. Yeah, later. But now I appreciate that one cannot enter into Vrindavan. I tried it. I tried to enter by living there for a long time. Couldn't enter. Could not enter. But one who dives into the pastimes of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, says Narottam Das Thakur, will emerge into the ocean of the pastimes of Radha and Krishna. So this is where we are. We are now in this pastime of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. We are somehow or other being transformed. And through us, amazingly enough, other people are being transformed. Why us? How us? But we are now, somehow or other, we are the agents of mercy. It's us. And why we have been chosen. Don't ask me. Don't ask me that, you know. I mean, like, from my perspective, Krishna could have chosen some more qualified ones. Right? Yeah, if I look at myself and even at some of my friends, you know, then I know, you know. I know Krishna could have really chosen some more qualified people. But somehow or other, he's chosen us. And then, yeah, Prabhupada was so happy with these Western disciples. Because he said they are doing more than the sannyasis. These householder disciples, they're doing more than the sannyasis. He was so happy with the enthusiasm. He was just so happy that they tried. That they tried to open temples, that they tried to preach, that they tried. He was so happy. And he's still so happy when we do it. And therefore, I'm also very happy if we do. And Krishna will be very happy. And then we'll have a happy end. And that's how you should end a story or a lecture, with a happy end. So that everyone walks away feeling like, good, a tragedy, you know, like it ends like. Like one Vyasa-puja, Shyamananda did like a play, which was all separation, and only separation, and there was no relief, and after that, like heartbroken for 3 days. Oh my God. Need some happy ends, I really need. Sometimes. So therefore the happy end of our festival will be in Amsterdam tomorrow. But we haven't come to the end yet. There's a bit more to come. Our cook is just sitting here completely relaxed. Which is very impressive, because usually cooks are in total anxiety. But he's just here, put all the time of the world. But it's all under control. And the feast was absolutely gorgeous yesterday. Yes. I ate it with my eyes. But I can see that it was first class. Yeah. So are there any questions and comments? I'll just first see who was there. Okay, yesterday you were last, today you're first.
Just from my reservations about the Lord and deity being non-different.
What?
The Lord, Krishna, and the deity being non-different, because I was thinking that, sorry for my wording, if Krishna stood there, why would we leave the temple? And if Srila Prabhupada is there.
Why did you leave the spiritual world?
But we're asked to do other services and do other things. But
now, why did you leave the spiritual world to begin with?
I don't know.
Because you wanted to try it out. You wanted to try, you know, to be in control and to be the center, to be in charge. And here in the temple, you come in, right? He's somehow or another met a devotee and he talked us into it. You know, he talked us into it and put on this orange dress and put this stuff on your nose and give you a book and give you a nice meal and you're sort of with a full belly and this and that. You know, you bought into it. And here you are, you know. And then, okay, you know, then there's the temple and it's nice. You know, Krishna's there and Prabhupada, but after a little while, it's like, well, now I want to be in the center again. Me, Guru Das the Great. And everyone is like this. It's very deep. So you recognize this desire to be great. That's why you can't stay in the temple. When you can be small, you can stay in the temple all day. Who was the next? You.
What is the proper way to understand not only get stressed because of this?
What is the proper way to understand?
To understand the dynamic about not only get stressed because he was doing a love song in the end of the night. And they are singing and glorifying Krishna all the time.
Or Indra or the Devatas,
yeah, like that. And yet they must come here for progress. Can they make spiritual progress from spirit, or if they chance?
Can they make spiritual progress from the heavenly planets? Yes, it is possible. It is even. Although it is Lord Chaitanya's movement is particularly happening on this planet, and therefore it is said the demigods are lining up to take birth now on this planet. But normally, in other yugas, there's not this special mercy of Lord Chaitanya. And it is possible to go up gradually. So the most pious amongst the demigods, who are doing very well, and they can go to higher regions. The Bhagavatam doesn't get much in detail about
the Mahar, Jhana, and Tapa lokas, or Brahma loka. But the Brihad Bhagavatamrita, Sanatana Goswami, gives detailed descriptions. And it says, the Mahar loka is the abode of the Prajapatis. The Prajapatis, they are living a very long time, and they're basically creating progeny. They're populating the universe. But these Prajapatis, they are always engaged in worship and in austerity. They're constantly trying to get purified, and then they conceive children. So it's quite a step up from the demigods, who are like very pious, but also in an enjoying spirit. So there's less enjoying spirit in the Prajapati and more sense of worship and doing it as a service. But it's still tinged and mixed. And then one can go to the Jhana Loka. There are great sages, right? Who are not. They may still be married, you know? But there are great sages, and they are just engaged in performing austerities. Tapaloka is the abode of the brahmacharis, and brahmaloka is the abode of the sannyasis. Right? Now I'm not talking about Vaishnavas, right? I'm talking just about Varnash. So in this way, the Brihad Bhagavatamrita describes that according to our sexual, our involvement with sexuality, we go further and further down into the universe. We're placed according to our involvement with sex somewhere into the universe. So that's a very, I marked and highlighted that point in the of the Brihad Bhagavatamrita as like one major point. As a major point, I mean, you know, you get placed somewhere in the universe according to your involvement with sex, higher or lower. So that's something to think about, you know. I mean, that's something to think about. So the demigods can go, some of them can go up to these Mahaloka, Janaloka, Tapaloka, Brahmaloka, and then at the end, when the end of Brahma's life, then those who are purely living with him in constant worship, they go back to Godhead. So one can also go back to Godhead like that, but you gotta be extremely pious. And who is like that? And I mean, if I look in the mirror, I was in Mayapur once, walking with Janani Vas, right? And he goes, it's very difficult to become a Brahmana. He said, it takes many, many births. He said, and we didn't have a very good birth to begin with. He said, it's very, very difficult. And I was thinking, well, if it's hard for you to become a Brahmana, then what about me? So it may be hard to go that way. Better come here and join Lord Chaitanya's mind.
Every time I get a little bit more serious about spiritual life or try to go deeper, I see how much I lack, how much it's there to do. So I got inspired to ask this question. When you quoted this verse, that it takes 100 lifetimes of chanting Hare Krishna to. So can we really make it in this lifetime?
Yeah. We can really make it in this lifetime because of all that added mercy. Katanchana smiteyas minduskaram sukaram. That by the added mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the result will come very quickly. So you chant for a little while, already you get someone's result. We see amazing people in this movement, amazing changes, amazing. Amazing. And yeah, can make it. You're already on the way. Yeah, doing good. Keep up the good work. And then it will happen. Of course, we've discussed that there's two elements, you know, the element of endeavor and the element of mercy. We're going to put so much emphasis on sadhana, perfect sadhana, I have to be perfect, devotee, everything has to be perfect. If you're not 100% strictly always perfect in the performance of your devotional duties, then you will go down again to the material world, and you will rot until you finally come to your senses, you sinful wretch, to how dare you have material desires. You will burn in the flames of your own material desires, you know. I mean, oh sinner, repent. That's not the Hare Krishna, that's the name. That's it. Okay. Gyana Samudra. Now wait for the mic, it's coming. Because the people in the other room, they can't hear you.
And on the internet. About 100 people watching.
Thank you very much, Maharaj, for reducing this room to a room of stool.
Did I?
Never
mind. Sorry for that.
But is there a quicker way that we can, engage the world in Krishna consciousness than what we're doing now?
Is there a quicker way that we can engage the world in Krishna consciousness than we're doing now? I mean, we should preach vigorously, with a lot of enthusiasm, with a lot of energy, and with a lot of purity. And these are like, we can see that in Srila Prabhupada. He was a pure devotee, but he was working like anything to somehow or other bring people to Krishna consciousness. It didn't just, Prabhupada didn't just sit there and the people started coming and start bowing down. Prabhupada said it takes gallons of blood to make a devotee. Yeah? So it's still preaching and purity that will do it. And purity, akama sarva kama vamoksha kama udarati tivrena bhakti yoga yeta purusham param, that whether we have material desires or not, we should take shelter of the process of pure devotional service. Then there's purity. So yeah, that's how the world will change. And the story of the sparrow and the eggs, that if we are the little sparrow trying to drink the ocean and trying to get the eggs back, if we try to take on the mission of changing the world, Krishna will come. He will come. He will do it. Because we can't. You see? Ultimately. But we have to attract him first by sincerity, like the little sparrow. Yeah. And who is sincere? It's a beginning of sincerity to ask yourself, am I sincere? That's a step towards sincerity. Am I actually sincere? Not sit on your cushion, comfy, and go, where's the maha? Sincere. Yeah, so on such a high note, we can maybe end. Turn a temple place full of stool and pus. How did I do that?
I'm seeing from a higher perspective.
Yeah, you're sitting. Thank you. Thank you for sharing this mercy. Thank you for sharing this mercy with us. That's appreciated. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Gyana Samudra Prabhu ki jai. Gopi Bhakta ki jai.